Hi guys, Duke of the Bump here. I'd like to take this opportunity to welcome you to Dungeon Hack. Welcome to Dungeon Hack. This is a dungeon crawler game released in 1993 for the PC, and it's like what would happen if you took a game like Rogue or NetHack, gave it Dungeons and Dragons rules, and slapped a first-person, real-time combat interface on it. In a way, this is one of the earliest action RPGs. Now, we could choose one of the prefabricated characters, but that's no fun. Let's make a character of our own. No, I'm not going to name him Dongs. Now, I could cheat and fudge the stats. You can make them whatever you want. But since this is an LP, I'll be doing this the honest way and rolling for my stats just like a real D&D player. Now, the three main stats that we want to look at are Constitution, which affects how many hit points we start out with, Dexterity, which affects our armor class, and Strength, which affects our combat ability. Charisma is pretty much useless in this game, and Intelligence and Wisdom are mainly only useful if you're a magic user or a cleric. So let's try to get good scores in those three stats. Decent scores, anyway. Hopefully this won't require too much rerolling. I recorded quite a few practice takes of this. Let me start the music. Quite a few practice takes, and whoa, that's pretty good. And dexterity is just not good enough. And in the practice takes, I always got good stats right off the bat. Of course, it's going to make me sit here rerolling over and over again, which is going to make for a terrible first video. Why does the game mock me like that? It's the LP's curse. Everything goes just fine until you start actually recording. Okay, yeah, that looks pretty good. Constitution of 17, Dexterity of 16. Now, what race you are also has an effect on your stats. If you're a human, nothing changes. If you're an elf, it gives you an extra point of dexterity at the cost of 1 point of constitution. If you're a dwarf, it's the other way around. Well, oh no, it takes it away from charisma, not dexterity. And gnomes are more intelligent, but less wise, apparently. And halflings, well, they're just sort of... Actually, that's pretty well balanced. I don't want to be a halfling, though. I want to be a dwarf, so I have an 18 constitution. I want to be a dwarven cleric. I'm male, and I will be true neutral. So, things are looking pretty good. Maybe I want to be an elf instead of a dwarf. Yeah, that gives me a better armor class. I'll start out as an elf. Okay. I am Duke the Elf. My keyboard is in kind of an awkward position because my right hand is on my trackball and my left hand is on the number pad, so it's kind of shoved over to the left a little bit. I've beaten the game on easy numerous times, never beaten it on moderate, and hard's pretty much impossible. Usually when I play a customized dungeon because you can get rid of some of the more annoying aspects later on, but since this is an LP and I'm trying to challenge myself, I'll go on ahead and play on moderate. This game doesn't have much in the way of music, so I've got some of my own playing in the background there. Hope it's not too intrusive. And we spent half this video on character creation. But just be glad you're not playing real D&D. Character creation takes even longer. Obsidian. You might think that that's a beautiful gem, but it's actually a key. And it is definitely not the last key we will find. In fact, all three of these items we've picked up so far have been keys. A better name for this game might have been, Jesus Christ, you guys, stop giving me so many keys, seriously. Hack. As you can see, we start with pretty standard cleric equipment. This is where that obsidian goes. it opens up this door to the right. We have a mace, which is standard clerical issue. It's not very powerful. Hopefully I want to do something about that. See, 4 points of damage, 4 points. Although I seem to be killing most of the stuff in one shot. Maybe I should stick with the mace. Maybe it's a good luck mace. And we have a huge clusterfuck of enemies over here. Rule number one when you're playing any sort of roguelike game, never let yourself get surrounded. That is one guaranteed way not to do well. And I found a rock. Okay, let's pause for a moment and take a look at some of these items that we found. This is an amulet. You can either put that, equip that around your neck, and sometimes that has an effect, or sometimes you put it in your hand and use it, and it has an effect like that. Before we do anything with the amulet, though, let's go to the camp subscreen. Here we can pray for spells, since we're a cleric. We have first and second level spells available to us. I want to get rid of one of these Cure Light Wounds and get a Detect Magic. And for second level spells, we have four Hold Persons, and I never use those. I want to get four Flame Blades instead. Also on the camp substring, you can rest. We have full hit points right now, but I want to rest anyway because that's how you get the spells that you pray for. We can see the totals of how many creatures we've slain. 6 goblins and 3 orcs. The Hall of Fame, which shows who died where. As you can see, I was killed by a ghoul on level 2. That was one of the few times that I've tried playing on hard. And we can leave the game, and of course we can save the game, which I'm going to go on ahead and do. The reason I save the game here is because we found a piece of equipment, and there's always a chance that it could be cursed. It was cursed and won't let me take this back off. Okay, good, it's not cursed. Let's see if it affects your stats in any way. You can see your stats by clicking on your character portrait. 18, 10, 18, 17, 16, 15. No, it doesn't affect our stats. Let's see if it does anything when we use it. Oh, okay. It is an amulet of magic missiles. That might come in handy later on. So we'll hang on to that. Yet another key. This time it's a crimson key. Perhaps it will take us to the court of the Crimson King. Or maybe not. It probably just opens up another door. Okay, and this is, although it doesn't look much like it, this is a lock. I know what you're saying. Duke, that's not a lock. You're crazy. That's a gong. Well, believe it or not, that opens up this door. Some sort of creature hiding in that crack down there. Just decoration. Anything you see on the walls or floors or ceiling is just decoration. Flavor text. Never anything important. Well, that's not true. There is one thing you want to look out for on the walls, and that's little cubby holes that sometimes contain items. Snuck up on him. Well, I memorized those flame blades, but I haven't used any of them yet, so let's show that off. When you cast it, it makes a magical blade appear in your hand. And, of course, I miss with it. Hey, a ring. Sweet. Save your game. And put that sucker on, see if it does anything. It's not cursed. It's a good sign. Nope, doesn't appear to do much of anything, as far as that goes. Let's see if it's magical. That's why I memorized Detect Magic. When you cast a spell, any magical items nearby will show up with a blue glow. It has some sort of magical property, but we can't tell what it does yet. So, I'm going to hang on to that. Hopefully, in the future, I will find an item that will allow me to identify it. If my inventory gets full before then, though, I might just toss it. Just taking up space, as it is. If you ever see me walk wildly into walls, it's because I'm looking for secret passages. Elves have an innate ability to locate secret passages, and sometimes when I'm near one, it'll tell me. But sometimes it won't, and I will have to just start bumping into walls wildly. Okay, it looks like we're just about out of time, so I'll go ahead and take a break here. Hope you enjoyed the first installment of Let's Play Dungeon Hack. I'm Duke of the Bump. Thanks for watching.